Hello everybody, thank you for coming to this presentation. So I'm going to talk about application based on data science, and that's pretty common in real life. How to build a classifier when you are faced with an imbalanced data set. So I work for IBM as a principal engineer. I've been working there for around 3.5 years. So I've been in the past developed many algorithms for machine learning for scalable big data platform. And recently I've been developing a data science use cases and application and doing some kind of research also. And so what's our agenda? So we're gonna talk about IBM and its commitment to the data science and what IBM is doing. And the second most important question, what you're gonna take home from this talk? So that's very important. So we're going to spend a small amount of time on that. And then what tools and technology we're going to use. Pretty much, we're going to address three main issues here. How to build a scikit-based ML pipeline. And second, what are the various model evaluation techniques, especially when you have a data set which is highly imbalanced. And the third, we're going to build a real model in a Jupyter notebook. In the end, if we have time, we're going to spend like 5-10 minutes on that. So with that, let's move on to the slides. So IBM has been investing a lot in open source and data science. So before that, our group was called STC, Spark Technology Center. But now it has been renamed to Codec, which we do a bunch of projects, like project around the Spark, data science, TensorFlow, and we also created a model asset exchange. It contains a bunch of models which are very helpful for real-life applications. So with that, IBM has created a software as well as the infrastructure for all the data scientists. We actually give 5 free machines in our cloud, and you get, I believe, close to 10 gigabytes of space, and you can hold it forever. So with that, I'm going to show you one video with IBM commitment. Oh, my video is gone. Oh, yeah, it's there. So how do I?
Video.
Yes, I wanna just reload. Yeah. No, not that. The circle. Yeah.
Data is everywhere. Making data simple and accessible to everyone gives it meaning. We've interviewed hundreds of data scientists to understand not just what they do, but how they think, how they learn, how they build off the work of others, and how they get feedback to improve their output. Step one is getting the right tools together in one place, with the data. We started with the open source tools that are familiar to so many, Jupyter Notebooks, RStudio, and we're working on incorporating many more. But data scientists do much more than work with data. They research previous efforts in the field, gather assets from searches, use tutorials to gain new insights, and exchange ideas with their peers. We're sharing the first steps of our journey, designing what will soon be the easiest way to do great things with data. Here's what it looks like. When you land on the homepage, you have immediate access to tools and data. Data from your organization, a marketplace of both free and premium data, and access to data stored on your machine. Filter the results to get to the content that you really care about and relates to your work. If you find a notebook that is related to your work, copy it into your project and give credit to the originator of the work. Here's where it gets interesting. The right side panel. We call it the Maker Palette. It allows you to drag and drop code snippets and algorithms from articles, comments, or projects right into your notebook. Watch tutorial videos in the Maker Palette while working on a notebook, without opening multiple windows from various websites. This data space is extremely powerful, not just because of the easy access and analysis of data, Although, of course, that capability is fundamental. It's the power of a community, the ability to easily learn from others, work with peers, discover work that moves the field forward. We can't wait to see what this becomes and what amazing work it enables.
So with that, so let's actually go into the meat of this presentation. So what we're gonna do in this talk? So there are many challenges we face in building a machine learning model. Somebody else gonna collect our data set. They may not collect all details. The data may be corrupted, or they may not have insufficient information. And then also people sometimes try to add extra features because they just wanna be careful. And there will be a lot of irrelevant columns and everything. So we're going to see how to take care of those things. And of course, once you build a model, there's a standard problem of overfitting and underfitting. And we'll see how to generalize it pretty well. So let's talk about one story that's very common. If we have a lot of data scientists here, so many of them may be familiar with this. Your boss or your customer comes to you and say, hey, I got this data set. I want you to build a classifier to predict whether somebody's going to buy our product or not. And you thought, oh, no problem. I'm going to build it. You follow all the standard rules. You build a machine learning model. You do a feature engineering. You do cross-validation. And you follow all the tricks and techniques of your books and your tutorial. But when you run your test model, it doesn't perform good, and you don't know why. And then you explore a little bit more, and you realize that the number of positive samples is very less. In this case, we are talking less than 1%, 0.001. And there are many applications where this happens. For example, you are building a model for detecting if somebody is going to click to an advertisement or not. In reality, less than 0.01% people click. So what happened is that when machine learning model builds that, learn from a data set, it considers those positive samples as some kind of noise. So it never learns. It thinks, oh, there's so little positive sample, it's more gonna learn from a negative sample. So it's something like you have like a five-year-old child, and you always wanna teach them A, B, C, D, but you never teach them 1, 2, 3, 4. But you just teach him one day. Do you expect him to know 1, 2, 3, 4? Of course not. So that's something, the similar analogy. So we're going to look how to mitigate those problems and solve that. So in this workshop, we'll see actually kind of a talk. How we're going to first explore a data set and see, is it really an imbalanced data set or not? Then we will use various pre-processing techniques, like one-hot encoding and things like that, to clean up our data. And then we naively build our first attempt to build a model, and we will analyze it. And we'll see that it doesn't perform good. Then we'll look into 3 or 4 techniques to make it better. Actually, we will improve it from 33% all the way till close to 90%. And in the end, we'll talk about smooth algorithm and oversampling techniques. So what tools and technology are we going to be using? So this Jupyter Notebook is particularly designed based on the scikit-learn, but you can definitely use R or Spark or any big data tool. It's just a technique. It can be applicable to anything else. But I believe most of the big data library like Spark or Hadoop doesn't have a lot of useful libraries compared to R or Python, but it's up to your use case. What's it gonna? So with that, we have chosen to use XGBoost. We could have used logistic regression or anything else. It just illustrates one of our concepts. Because XGBoost allows us to do a lot of tuning of the parameters, and if you look at the Kaggle, a lot of the competition winner usually use XGBoost. Nowadays, they are using deep learning to win the competition. And then it integrates very seamlessly with the Python and scikit way of doing things, estimator and ML pipeline. So that was a very good choice to use XGBoost. So I think you might be familiar with what is a tree-based machine learning algorithm. So I'm going to go over very short. But there is a very detailed tutorial in the official website. There's a link and everything. So what actually happening that you want to predict something, so you get a data set. You pretty much build a tree. So in this case, we get a data set of a bunch of people, and our features are age, gender, occupations. And we want to see if they want to play computer games or not. So of course, you can build a tree. And they say, oh, if you are younger generation, you're more likely to play a computer games. And a male is more likely to play a computer game than a female. But that's one tree. What if there is another possibility? Instead of splitting on first on age, what if I split on something else? So here is an example of tree two. Here we are splitting it based on the whether you use computer every day or not. So what it shows that when you build a tree, you can build a tree many, many ways. So which tree to use? So there are multiple approaches. In the random forest approach, you kind of build multiple trees on a subset of features, and then you create an ensemble of models. But XGBoost is a little bit different on that. So instead of building multiple tree, so look at this equation. So what it does is that you build a first tree, and then you figure out what's your error. And once you find out the error, you build a second tree only on the errors. And the third tree you build based on the error created by first and second tree. And fourth tree, all the previous tree. So what it allows us to do is that instead of having n number of trees or n number of cooks, you just pick one cook and you iteratively refine it until you get a good enough performance. And that's in short the whole idea of a boosting tree. And there's a very nice tutorial from a creator of XGBoost. His name is T. Jian, and he's a professor in Washington University. You can look at the whole tutorial. But this is a whole idea of that. So now let's look at the what typically data scientists do and how they build their model. So first they read the input, then they do exploration just to get a feel of your data, that what's happening and what they want to do. And of course, then you want to clean your data, remove some strings into one-hot encoding or normal numeric encoding and things like that. And then you do a feature engineering, and then you build a model. Usually, model building is a very iterative process. Means you do some, you create one hypothesis, and you build your model. And you test it. Oh, you like it? That's good. Go. But if you don't like it, you keep on iterating. So that's, and in the end, you're going to test your model in the data set which you never seen it before so that you can really see how good your model is. Okay. So before we build a model, as I talked about, that one of the important things of building a model is an iterative process. When you're doing an iteration, you need some kind of measurement criteria to see which model is better. So of course, like we have education system where A, B, C, D, so saying somebody get A is a better student and things like that. So in a model universe, there are multiple metrics. You can use it. It's not like saying one matrix is better than another. It's for saying, for a particular use case, one matrix is more better than the another one. So probably everybody know about accuracy score. It's just you build your model, you see how many of sample it correctly classified divided by the total number of sample. It's a very simplistic score. They call accuracy score. And it works perfectly fine in a fairy tale world. Means like your data set contains balanced data set, number of positive samples is approximately same as number of negative samples. But there are certain cases where you cannot actually rely on the accuracy score. Because accuracy score just care about how many things you correctly classified. So there is another matrix they call is confusion matrix. So confusion matrix is nothing but just saying that you have some data set. There is actual positive. Let's say somebody want to detect if it is a fraud transaction or not. So that is the actual ground truth. But your model may say, hey, this is a actual fraud. That's pretty good. That's true positive. But your model may say, no, that's not a positive. So the sample originally was positive sample, but your model is saying negative. So that's called false negative. So similarly, the definition of false positive and true negative is there. So your goal is that you want to maximize these green color parameters and minimize the red color parameters. But it also suffers from some discrepancy, especially for the cases when the data is imbalanced. And so there is another matrix we call receiver operating characteristic. It actually comes from the older time, from Army days, when we used to detect Army ships from radar and everything. So what it does is that it's just a ratio, odd ratio of true positive versus false negative. So on one axis, you plot this equation on the top, and another axis, you plot equation in the bottom. The key idea here is that it measures your model's ability to detect a positive sample as a positive and a negative sample as a negative. And why it is very important, because especially when you are doing a medical kind of model, like, you know, some cancer prediction and all those, you want to detect all the positive samples. But you don't want to say somebody, hey, you have a cancer, but he doesn't have a cancer because his life is emotionally destroyed. So you want to balance between a true positive and true negative. And so that's the one of the use cases where you want to use a receiver operating characteristic. So a little bit more details on the receiver operating characteristic. So what really happens is that confusion matrix, okay, on the left-hand side, on the top left-hand side, we have two distribution, one for the positive, true positive, and on the left is for true negative. We know that in real life, there is no one definite answer. There is a gray area. So this gray area in machine learning, we especially represent using a distribution. And Gaussian distribution is very, very common on that. So if you look at the curve on the top left-hand corner, there is two curves, and they kind of tends to overlap. And you may notice there's a vertical line. By moving the vertical line, I can change the definition of positive and negative. So what it means is that in a medical, let's say you did your blood test or some kind of medical test, and your doctor say, you know, if I put a threshold of 0.5, you more likely, I think your test result say you have a cancer. But you know, 0.5 is a not good threshold. I'm going to reduce it a little bit to 0.3. But then your probability of having cancer is very less. So this ability for tuning a model by changing the threshold from a default 0.5 to 0.3 or 0.7 is a very powerful technique. Because using this tuning parameter, you can tune your model for specific use cases. This ROC curve is very commonly used for medical kind of things, like especially if you do some kind of testing related to what's your chances of having certain kind of disease or not. So when you move this threshold, and in the bottom figure, that black dot moves around that. So your goal is that you want to move this dot in such a way that the area under that curve is maximized. So that's the key idea of our ROC curve. It works perfectly fine, but it turns out that it doesn't work perfectly well when your data is imbalanced, means we are talking about less than 1% positive samples. So then there is another matrix they call as a precision recall curve. And there's a slight difference why it works. So this is the same matrix, one of the parameters are same, and you may notice, let's just look at the numerator. So numerator, we are comparing TP versus TP. So in an imbalanced data set, true positive is going to be very small. So you are comparing two small numbers. So when you plot these two things on your visually, you may be able to notice the differences between them because these numbers are very, very small. But let me go back into this equation. In this equation, one equation is TP, and the second numerator of a second equation is TN. So in an imbalanced data set, TN gonna be really, really huge. Let's say you are trying to predict if your customer gonna buy your product or not. True negative gonna be like 990 out of one sample, means those people are not gonna buy your product. Only 10 people gonna buy it. So when you plot number 10 and 990, you may not be able to notice a small changes happens in the true positive because it will be dwarfed by the bigger picture on the which is TN. But that problem doesn't exist with the precision recall curve. So typically, you would like to use precision recall curve for the cases where you have the imbalanced data set. And that is a key idea. We started from accuracy curve, confusion matrix, ROC curve, and precision recall. It's nothing like one is better or something. It's a use cases, depending upon your business use case, you want to use one or the other. Now, this graph illustrates one of the key points. Precision and recall have an inverse relationship. Means you want to make something highly precise, where recall gonna be go down. So then you again in dilemma, which one to optimize, precision or recall? So then engineers and data scientists, they are like more resourceful people. They come up with that, hey, we want to optimize two things. Why not just take a harmonic mean of both of them? So that's what we call F1 score. But in our use case, F1 score may not be the best thing to do. And why is it so? Because as we notice, precision and recall gonna have an inverse relationship. And we already proved that in our imbalanced data set, precision recall is much better. So do you want to build your model on the matrix of precision or the recall? The answer is, you have to go to your business person. Whoever is your client or your manager or whoever gave you the problem, ask them where you are building this model for. I can give you an example here. So there is a lot of explanation, but in the interest of time, I'm going to just talk in a little bit higher level. So let's say you are building a machine learning model for Net Nanny. Means it is the ability to block bad website for your kids, like who are young. So in this case, what's your goal? You definitely don't want your kid to see even one bad website. And you don't care if your machine learning model say that your CNN website is bad. But as long as your machine learning model detects all the bad website, you are happy. So in this case, you really, really want high precision. And you don't want a high recall. So if you are building this use case, you want to choose high precision, because you cannot optimize precision and recall at the same time. But look at the another example. Let's say you are trying to predict if some of the customer are going to buy from your shop or not. Or maybe you have some financial product, you want to make sure customer do buy it or not. What is your goal there? The goal is that, hey, I want to predict some customer whether he's going to buy or not. If I predict he's going to buy, I'm going to give you incentive, like 20% off or things like that. But what if my prediction is wrong? It's OK. I predicted this customer going to buy from my shop, and he didn't buy. But that's OK. But I was able to reach out to all the potential customers. So in this case, the cost of mistake is not that high. So in this case, you may want to have higher recall instead of higher precision. So once we understand this matrix, now it becomes a simpler step, like how are we going to optimize our model. So let's go into a model training steps. So as I talked about, model training is a pretty iterative process. First, you pick up a model based on certain criteria and certain input features, and you train it, and then you evaluate using the matrix. In our case, we're going to use recall because we are predicting whether a customer is going to buy your bank product or not. And then you adjust, and then you iterate again and again. So in the first attempt, what we will do, we will naively build our XGBoost model, and we'll see its performance is not good. Then what can we do to improve its performance? Because we know that out of 1,000 sample, in reality, you may have million sample or whatnot, but let's assume there is 1,000 sample, and only 10 of them is positive. Then, of course, the obvious approach is that since your machine learning model is considering those 10 guys as a noise, why not increase its weight? So instead of giving every sample equal weight, just give the positive sample higher weight. You can try weight of 1, 10, 100, 1,000, 10,000, and run your cross-validation and see your performance. Once you see your performance, you can choose the right amount of weight. So that is what we call weighted class classifier strategy. And the second strategy, so this is the plot it looks like for a different kind of weights. And probably the font is too small, but we try from weight 1 till all the way till 10,000. So in this case, since we are trying to optimize the recall, but we don't want to make our precision really, really bad. So instead of taking 10,000 weight, we choose 1,000 weight because we also have to take care of overfitting problem. Now the second approach to solve this problem is a minority oversampling and majority undersampling. So this is kind of related to a weighted things. So instead of giving a high weight, so not every machine learning model allow you to change the weight as a tuning parameter. What if you try to use the logistic regression? In that case, there is no weight parameter. So what you have to do manually, the undersampler, you have only 10 samples which are positive. You can just duplicate it like 10 more times. So instead of 10 samples, you got 100 samples. And what you can do, because you have 990 majority samples, you can undersample it. So you can make them like around 300 or something. So if they are about close to each other, then your classifier tends to perform pretty good. So you're going to get a pretty good result. And you build your model, your boss is happy and all those. But your boss comes next week and say, hey, I mean, Joe or whatever, Mr. X or YZ or whatnot, you know, your model really works, but our competitor is also doing the same thing. We have no competitive edge. So what you can do to get this little bit extra edge to beat your competition? So that's what this paper came out from Chawla and others. They call synthetic minority oversampling techniques. Intuitively, when you copy a sample, it's like a cheating. So what we can do to correct the class imbalance problem? So it's a very nice paper. You can please read it. But I'm going to visually try to explain in a like a simplistic term. The big blue dot circle is a majority sample, and the smaller one is a minority sample. The smaller, big red color. So what we do, we choose the two minority samples, and we create a new synthetic sample, which is based on the interpolation between them. So please note that interpolation will be not always in the middle. You generate a random number between 0 and 1, and you pick somewhere in between. So the way I like to think is that a baby, sometime a baby 1 looks like mom, a baby 2 looks like dad. So they are kind of interpolation between mom and dad. So they don't get 100% from one parent, but you cannot guarantee. So that's the same idea. You kind of randomly choose how much percentage you're going to get from sample 1 and sample 2. And it may turn out that on your decision boundary, you may see there's a blue color big circle, and you may interpolate a red with a big red circle with a small, blue circle, and you will get a hybrid. But you don't want it to create a synthetic sample based on the majority sample. But that's okay, because remember that on the decision boundary, there will be few mistakes. So even though you create a synthetic sample, which is a hybrid of smaller, like red and blue, that's okay, because it's not going to be too many. You can just blindly follow this type of thing. But it turns out that it is computationally too expensive, because if you have graph and you have endpoint, if you try to connect all the possibilities, NC2, It's like an N-square kind of thing. So what we can do in practice is that instead of doing all the NC2 possibility, you only create a K nearest neighbor. So you create a, okay, yeah, I think it's, so you create a circle and you only look at the minority sample within this circle and create a synthetic sample. Once you do that, you definitely gonna have a competitive edge compared to your competitor who just copied his minority sample into that. And that is a key idea. So I'm gonna show a little bit on the Jupyter notebooks. I think I have 10 minutes, so I can go over in that. So I may not have time to go in details on all the things because it's a really big notebook, like, but the key idea has been explained in this presentation, and it's around 50 to 60 pages once you take a printout. And the notebook is in the IBM GitHub, and the slides are in the my personal homepage. And I'm gonna update the latest slide here in like maybe half hour. And you can use it to on your laptop or in your IBM Watson Studio. So with that, let me go to the Jupyter notebook. And Jupyter, I want to show the next one. So I think yeah, this is a little tricky for me. So. Data set, and then we figure out that, hey, it's really an imbalanced data set problem. And then we go around and explore a little bit more. We do a correlation plots here, and we also do a heat map plot, and we figure out that some of the columns are correlated. But that's okay, because XGBoost is pretty robust for the correlated column. But your company policy or your CTO or head of data science will say, hey, we don't want to use XGBoost. Just use the linear model like support vector machine or the logistic regression. In this case, you have to be very careful. If something is correlated, you want to remove the correlated column. Otherwise, your performance of the model will be really bad. And with that, we do our first attempt. We build a pipeline, and we do our first attempt to build a model. And I'm going to show you the confusion matrix graph. I mean, you can go in details. There's a lot of explanation in that. So in first attempt, please look at this number in the like one. Because remember, we only care about our positive sample. And our first attempt, our recall is only 33%. That's too bad. So what we can do, so as we talked about, we're going to use a weighted classifier here. And once we use our weighted classifier, and I run my model again, and I would like your attention to be pointed to this row containing one, and you may notice that we have increased it to a 98% at the expense of precision, because in our use case, it's okay to be have a little bit less precision. So that's pretty good, but this is only on our training data set. And we will see that our training data set, 98%, how does it generalize into the data it has never seen it before. And this is the result. So we get 84% on a data it has never seen it. Means we were able to improve the performance of a classifier for the imbalanced data set from 33% all the way till 84 or 85%. And because we decided what we want to optimize. And you may notice that overall, it's 70% the precision and recall combination, but we only care about recall here. And in the end, we also have the exam proper links to the all the papers and examples. So one of the things I wanted to point out is about feature engineering. The example is also there. So in the feature engineering, what we do here is that originally the model was built on the 50 features, but we achieve the same performance using the 17 features. And the way we achieve it, because XGBoost has this very nice feature they call like feature importance, and they use entropy-based system to figure out what are the important features. So one of the key advantages of using a less number of features is that your model will generalize much better. So that's the key idea from that. And let me go back to the slide again. Okay. I think I cannot go back, but in the, I think that's pretty much the done. I had a slide saying question and answer. So with that, I will take any questions. Thank you. Yes, please.
The first, okay, I give you a microphone. Can we have a microphone, please? Yes. Don't worry. Take your time. Great. You can go. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Hi, thanks for the talk. I was, I found the SMOTE paper very, I mean, you mentioned it, I found it very, very interesting. My question is, if you interpolate data to represent this minority sample more, what happens if this new data, this artificial data you create, what happens if it overlaps with the other majority data? So if there's point A, point B, and you make a point in the middle, what happens if that is it? If this overlaps with the other data, so essentially, yeah, you're confusing the one you create with the other one.
Okay, so I think, can we go back to a slide? Oh, I think, so I have a, I mean, in my picture, there is a specifically mentioned, there's one blue circle on the left-hand side. So typically in the machine learning theory, what happens, no matter whatever classifier you do, there will be some kind of decision surface. So let's say in the two-dimensional, there will be some curve. So on the one side of the curve, you will be mostly one decision. So in this case, our minority sample will be one side of the curve, and majority sample will be on the other side of the curve. But there is nothing called perfect system. So there is a possibility that some of the majority will go onto this side of the minority side. So in this case, the SMOOTE paper recommends that you first identify a decision boundary and you create a sample at the decision boundary area. So what happened is that when, let's say, for example, if my this particular thing is a decision boundary, because let's say we are only three guys on this side, so we are minority sample and there are like hundreds of people there, so that's a majority one. So now, if we consider this as a decision boundary, then, of course, if somebody is behind that a lot far, you don't have to worry because you are overly confident that that's really a minority sample. But if I'm close to this decision boundary, I could be there or here, I don't know, right? Because my model could be wrong. So if I create more sample around this area where we have confusion, and you run your model again, you are more likely to create a better model. And to answer your question specifically, even though, let's say, some guy from that side come over here, so from majority side, he come over there. But those kind of things happen very small. So even though you create some hybrid sample, that's okay, because your machine learning will say that there is five minority sample and one majority sample. So that will be considered as a noise. So that will take care of that problem, even though there are some overlapping issues. Because remember, like, there's nothing called as a perfect solution, but in majority cases, we'll win. Hopefully that answers your question. Thank you. Yes, yeah. I think it's been used by a lot of big companies to take care of their needs. Like, I know for sure that, yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Any further question? There is any other question? If not, you can go to ask the expert. Oh, over there, there is a guy with your hand up. Let me, I'm gonna go faster, and I'm gonna run. And I'm gonna try to do my best, okay? Or I can throw the microphone to you, but will be not the best option. That's for you. Here you are.
Thank you very much for your talk. My question is about when do you recommend going for a smooth? Because obviously smooth needs more processing power than using just a weighted sample or a weighting class. So what is the point where you say, okay, no, actually smooth should be the one you have to use. So when do you recommend going for one or the other?
So I think creating a machine learning model is never been a science like you have a Newton equation, force equal to mass into acceleration. It's kind of fixed, right? But data science is a little bit more like data arts. So for example, weighted one will give you some better result. So it's always about the competition. If your competitors are doing better than you, what you can do to create a better result? So you can try multiple approaches. First, of course, weighted samples, and then you can try oversampling of a minority sample, and then, of course, a smooth algorithm. So nowadays, you don't have to code everything from a ground level, because most of the standard library in R or Python, they do contain a package to create Astra samples out of the smooth algorithm. So you just have to make a function call. But as you mentioned that for the certain large amount of data set, you can always use this parameter called K. K will only look for the K nearest neighbor, and that will be able to take care of your if it runs for a long time. And there are, of course, other techniques. You can create a better pre-processing. You can create a derived features and other. I touch one aspect of that. Assuming you have created a feature engineering and everything, and you're still not able to beat your competitors or your clients are not happy, what would you do? So, thank you very much.